Hello and welcome to the sixth of nine videos for chapter one. In this video, I'm going to be talking about sections 125 and 126 of the text. The topics are translating disjunctions and conditionals. And as we'll see, conditionals take up almost all of this. Disjunctions are pretty straightforward, but conditionals are not. So let's get into disjunctions first. So a number of ways to express disjunction in English. So a standard one is to use or. Dallas will win the Super Bowl, or Buffalo will win the Super Bowl. Sometimes you can use either or. Dallas will win the Super Bowl, or Buffalo. Either Dallas will win the Super Bowl, or Buffalo will win. You can use unless. Dallas will win the Super Bowl unless Buffalo will win it. Unless is a little tricky. In fact, all of these operators are tricky. Let me point out, in particular with unless, if you go to the online syllabus, there is a link to a discussion of unless that I had with one of the TAs a while back. And we go have a back and forth about what unless really means. This will make more sense after we get through chapter two. I would suggest don't even look at that until you've got chapter two under your belt. But the point is that a lot of these operators are more complex than how we're making them out. And if you want to see some further layers of that complexity, go ahead and click on that link and you'll see a back and forth between myself and one of the TAs a while back in this course. But the same sort of discussion could happen for any of the operators, not just unless. Okay, so let's go back to this disjunction. If we have this disjunction, we can find the two atomic statements. Dallas will win the Super Bowl, call that D. B will be Buffalo will win the Super Bowl. If we rewrite the original statement, we get this, and we'll use this wedge as a symbol for disjunction. So D or B. And just as with conjunction, it's useful to have a name for the components of a disjunction. We will call them disjuncts. So in the disjunction D or B, D is the first disjunct, B is the second disjunct. That was pretty quick. Now we're going to get to conditional. Conditional is not going to be quick. This is the most complicated of the operators. Once we get through this, actually translating isn't any more time consuming than translating the others. It's just a little more difficult to see why it is that we translate them the way that we do. First off, let's see some examples of conditionals. If you earn exactly 900 points, you will get some form of A. That means an A minus, A or A plus. By the way, I often use grading policies as examples. None of them reflect official grading policy in this course, by the way. That's on the syllabus and was discussed in class. Any examples I use for logical purposes are just fictional examples. You can also leave out the then. I can just say, if you earn exactly 900 points, you will get some form of A. Now, conditionals are challenging because the order of the components in a conditional isn't reversible. That's one of the things that makes conditionals challenging. The other two-place operators we've had, negation is one place. Negation just operates on one component to make a bigger compound. But the other three operators, conjunction, disjunction, and conditional, all operate on two components to put together a bigger compound. The other two, conjunction and disjunction, are order invariant. Okay, order doesn't matter. So, for example, if someone says roses are red and violets are blue, that's the same thing as violets are blue and roses are red. You can switch the order, and it means the same thing. Quick footnote on this. Even though they mean the same thing, you should still translate them correctly. So if I have roses are red and violets are blue, and assign R and V to those atomic statements, I would get R dot V. I wouldn't get V dot R. Yes, these two mean the same thing, but this is what I said. I had, in this sentence I used, I had the atomic statement R first, and the atomic statement V second. So keep them in the same order. Yeah, they mean the same thing, but they're still different statements. So don't translate it as that. Same thing is true with disjunction. Order doesn't matter. So I can say the Cavs or the Warriors will win, or I could say the Warriors or the Cavs will win. Same thing. This is parallel to the arithmetic operators again. Some of them are order invariant. So addition, order doesn't matter. 5 plus 3 is the same as 3 plus 5. Multiplication, order doesn't matter. 2 times 7 is the same as 7 times 2. But for some of the arithmetic operators, order does matter. 5 minus 3 is not the same as 3 minus 5. And 2 divided by 7 is not the same as 7 divided by 2. Same thing is true of conditional. If you are a billionaire, then you can afford donuts. Does not mean the same thing as if you can afford donuts, then you are a billionaire. Okay, these mean different things. So order matters for conditionals. Since the order matters for conditionals, we're going to need two different names for these two components. Okay, the one that we can't just call them, like with disjunctions, we can call them both disjuncts. And with conjunction, we can call both components conjuncts. We can use the same name for the two components because it doesn't matter. They're the same. The order is irrelevant. With conditional, order matters. So we're going to need a different name for the two components. Okay. And the two components, we're going to call the antecedent and the consequent. So these are the two components of a conditional. We're going to use a horseshoe as our symbol for translating the conditional. And we're always going to put the antecedent in the formal notation, antecedent first on the left, consequent second on the right. So in the formal notation, it's always going to look like this: antecedent, horseshoe, consequent. Okay? Now, formal notation is easy. The problem is that natural language, like English, doesn't use linear order. It doesn't always put the antecedent on the left and the consequent on the right. Okay? So in order to translate from English into the formal notation, we have to figure out in the English which one is the antecedent and which one is the consequent. Okay? Because you can't tell just by looking at which one came first. This means there's two steps to translating a conditional. The first step is just realizing that it's a conditional. That's easy because it's going to use if or if then or only if. But the word if is going to be involved. In the normal material. In the optional material, we're going to look at a couple of other ways of expressing conditionals in English with necessary and sufficient conditions. But for purposes of the regular material, the word if is going to be involved in all the conditionals we're going to look at. Once you've determined that the English is expressing a conditional, you need to figure out which component is the antecedent and which one is the consequent, because you need to know which one to put on the left and which one to put on the right of the horseshoe in the formal notation. So first off, how can you tell if it's a conditional? Well, these are the main ways conditional is expressed, and they all use the word if. I could say if A, then B. You can leave the then out. I can say if G, H. I can say K, if L. Or sometimes you can say only if, M, only if N. So these are the four main ways of expressing conditional in English, the ones that we're going to look at in the normal material. So if you see the word if, you know there's a conditional. Next question is, how can you tell which component, the A, the B, the G, the H, the K, the L, M, N, which component is the antecedent and which one is the consequent? Well, here's how. First off, there's two possibilities in English. They all use if, but there's two different cases. Either it's using if by itself without an only. Maybe there's a then, maybe there isn't a then, but it's not only if. or it is only if. So if we look back here, this was if by itself, if is just by itself, if is by itself, and here it's only if. Okay, so these are the two different possibilities. First, let's just look at if by itself. If the English has an if by itself, not part as an only if, then the statement that immediately follows that word if is going to be the antecedent. And then the other statement is the consequent. Okay, so that means you have something like if P then Q, what do? Well, we know it's a conditional because the word is if, right? And it's not only if, it's just if. So we identify that whatever statement immediately follows that is going to be the antecedent. So there's our if, then statement immediately following is P, so that's the antecedent. The other statement is the consequent. So in the formal notation, we're going to have a horseshoe. P will be the antecedent on the left, Q will be the consequent on the right. So it'll be P horseshoe Q. Okay. If A, B. Same thing, it's not only if. It's just if by itself, so we find the if. The next statement, the statement immediately following if, is the antecedent. The other statement, in this case B, is the consequent. So it's still a horseshoe, antecedent on the left, consequent on the right. So A horseshoe B. What about C if D? Also, the word if is there, so we know it's a conditional. We're going to have a horseshoe. It's not only if, so we can use the same rule as before. It's just whatever follows the if. So there's the if. Statement immediately following it is D, so that's going to be our antecedent. The other statement is the consequent. Okay, so D is the antecedent, so that in the formal notation goes on the left. Consequent goes on the right. So here's a case where the order is different in English and the formal notation. Okay, but this is the correct translation of that. What about only if? This is the other option. If English uses only if, then the statement immediately following only if is the consequent. And then the other statement will be the antecedent. So if I say K only if L, you'll pass the class only if you turn in all the homework, something like that. Well, it's only if, so we spot the only if. Whatever follows the only if is the consequent, so L will be the consequent and go on the right. The other statement is the antecedent and will go on the left, so K horseshoe L. Okay, so now let's do some examples of translating conditionals. If you are a billionaire, then you can afford to buy donuts. Step one, as always, identify the atomic statements. You are a billionaire, you can afford to buy donuts. We'll rewrite by plugging in the letters for the atomic statements. If B, comma, then D. To keep that comma there, that's going to be important, as we'll see later. It turns out it's not going to be important now, but just get in the habit of keeping punctuation there, especially commas. Well, it's conditional, because it's using if, so we're going to have a horseshoe. What's the antecedent? Well, it's using if, so the statement immediately following the if, well, there's the if, what immediately follows? B. So B is going to be the antecedent, and then the other statement then is the consequent, so that'll go there. All right, what about this one? The sidewalks will get wet if it rains. Atomic statements, the sidewalks will get wet, R, it rains. Rewrite, S if R. It's conditional, because it's using if. Statement immediately following if is antecedent, so R will be the antecedent. The other statement, S, will be the consequent, so R is the antecedent, R will be first on the left, so it'll be R horseshoe S. There's the antecedent. R immediately follows, so it's, sorry, there's F. R immediately follows, so it's the antecedent. You can make bread only if you have flour. Well, here's our atomic statements. You can make bread, you have flour. If we rewrite, we get B only if F. Well, it's using only if, so the statement immediately following an only if is the consequent. So that means F will be the consequent. It'll go on the right. The other statement is the antecedent and go on the left. So B horseshoe F. Okay, so now to summarize conditionals and why they're a pain. In English, and other natural languages too, but we're using English, which statement is the antecedent and which is the consequent is not coded by linear order. Okay, linear order meaning left, right, which one's first, which one's last. Okay, sometimes the antecedent's first, sometimes the antecedent's last. Sometimes the consequent is first, sometimes the consequent is last. So the linear order is not what English is using to code for which statement is the antecedent and which is the consequent. Okay? Rather, English uses adjacency to keywords. The statement immediately following if is always the antecedent, even if the if is at the end, right? Like B if A. Right? Whatever immediately follows if is the antecedent in natural language in English. Okay, so in English you ignore the order, you look for those keywords, and in particular for which component follows the if or the only if. Our logical notation, on the other hand, does use linear order to code which is the antecedent, which is the consequent. Antecedent is always first on the left, consequent is always second on the right after the horseshoe. Okay, so to summarize how to do that, if the conditional uses if, not only if, but it's using if, then the statement immediately following if is the antecedent, and the other statement is the consequent. For conditionals using only if, the statement following only if is the consequent, and the other statement is the antecedent. Okay, that's it for this video. Next up, we're going to be doing just a lot of practice translating compound statements using all four operators with multiple levels of recursion.